So thanks for coming to this talk. There's a strong competition in this lot, so thanks for coming. And I would like to also thank the organization for allowing me to speak again this year in this event, especially being such an important milestone, having 10 years of conference, it's quite significant. So this talk is about modern software architectures. And to get started, I would like to introduce myself. So my name's Ricard. I was born and grown up in Barcelona. I've been living in London for almost 2 years now. And these days, I'm working as a server engineer in this video game studio called Another Place Productions, doing a little bit of DevOps, backend work, trying to provide infrastructure to these guys. Game's not launched yet, but hopefully in some months they will become popular, so keep an eye on us, please, if you like video games, of course. Must confess, I'm not doing much PHP these days. I'm doing Java, sorry about that. Yeah, you know. It's not that bad. Yeah, I knew this was going to happen. I need to be honest. I try to contribute to open source, but now in Java I cannot do it that much because I'm not pretty good at it. And I'm an occasional speaker. So if you want to follow me on Twitter, send me an email or anything, you can contact me at these details. So a bit of agenda. We'll talk about the new way we build software architectures and how this affects the technical teams. Most of the talk will be about SOA, microservices, distributed systems, all these hype words that the industry is having these days. We'll touch a little bit of the data storage, NoSQL databases, real-time stream processing, all these fancy tools, complementing a little bit of the talk that Ben Wayne did just some minutes before. And to end the talk, I'll talk about some different languages for different problems, depending on what you're trying to achieve, and where does PHP fit in this new world of containers, microservices, where it looks like such a slow, not compiled language does not fit. But I think it still has some places where it shines. So why this talk? Yeah, as I said, the way we build applications has changed. And a result of that is that many people over-engineer for pretty much no reason. They are trying to build systems for some scale that possibly they will never achieve. And also, if you are on Hacker News or you follow many people in Twitter, I honestly think that this industry is a bit full of stupid trends and hypes. It looks like if these days you're not doing Go, Cassandra, microservices, you're doing it wrong. And well, there's plenty of businesses generating millions of pounds, dollars, euros, whatever, just with plain PHP and MySQL, and there's nothing wrong with that. And those who know me know that I like to rant a little bit, so it's a bit of a rant talk as well, but allow me to do that. So let's get started with the applications evolution. Bit of Lego bricks. As I said, lots of projects start like this. Very simple, classic LAMP stack. I don't know if any of you are still having similar stacks like this one, but there's nothing fundamentally wrong. You can even have a pretty monolithic PHP code base, but it can be fully tested. It can be more or less decoupled. You can have some dependency injection framework. You can use something like Symfony. And there's nothing wrong with that. You can pretty much use MySQL, PostgreSQL, Oracle, if you have the budget for that, even Microsoft SQL Server. I'm not sure about that, but some people do. And again, there's nothing fundamentally wrong. You can generate millions of pounds, and there are lots of e-commerces out there with pretty much this setup. And you know, I don't know why people sometimes try to blame PHP for not being valuable for the industry, where it's proven that it's pretty well. Then you know, traffic starts to grow, and then you start experimenting. You add some Nginx, maybe some Varnish cache. Depending on your application, you may need some in-memory database, maybe Memcache, maybe Redis. PHP is brilliant for horizontal scaling, so the traffic grows, you just add more servers, and provided you have some session storage mechanism, you should be fine. You may even discover that some endpoints may be better done in another language, so you can start cheating on PHP using some Python, some Java, even some Erlang or Go, depending on how brave you are. And same happens in the storage. I mean, maybe you think or you have some domain problems that traditional databases are not the best ones to solve. So maybe you are introducing some Cassandra to store time stream series events. Maybe you are using some document database like Mongo or Couchbase or something similar. Maybe you are running an e-commerce and you need to be able to do full text search. So find technologies for that, maybe Apache Solr, maybe Elasticsearch, something like that. And if you have a lot of operations that need to happen in the background, you may introduce some queue systems like RabbitMQ. There's plenty of them, Beanstalk, ZeroMQ. They are all slightly different, but the goal of them is being able to distribute some load to background processes. And with a setup like that, you can pretty much scale like Facebook has proven. They started with PHP. They've been adding many things. They are not possibly using PHP that much, but it was gradually. And they only added these pieces when they needed, not upfront. And this is one of the this is why Facebook was able to scale that fast to that, the scale they have now, which is pretty much only comparable to Google or Amazon or these pretty big guys. And something like that is mostly fine. However, sometimes you get to projects where they tell you, oh, we're using NoSQL databases. We have lots of languages in the system. And it's a bit of a mess because you have over-engineered for no reason. Most of your servers are only using 1% of CPU load, so you are underutilizing most of your infrastructure. And the thing is that the more technologies you add to your stack, the harder it becomes to maintain and develop with. And obviously, new problems happen. And most of the times, or sometimes, you can even ultimately harm the company by doing that. Maybe you started with your best intentions because you were expecting some scale traffic and you needed all these things, but maybe you just did it just in case it happened and it never happens. And another thing that happens quite often still in the PHP community is the non-invented here syndrome. There's still people out there building their own frameworks, their own ORMs, even their own autoloads, because you know they think that it's slightly faster. And yeah, you may gain a couple of microseconds maybe, but you are adding new problems and new legacy code. So unless you have very good reasons for doing that, just use the tools out there who are well-maintained, used by many people, and hundreds of people reviewing that can only be much better than your development team, even if you are the best developers in the world. So another big thing that happens these days, I don't know how many of you are running part of your infrastructure or all your infrastructure in the cloud. Most people are moving to that because obviously, you pay only for what you use. You can save money in operations. And OK, you need to code or think about your architecture slightly different because you are sharing resources with many other clients inside this provider. So it's a bit more likely that bad things happen in your system. So you need to add redundancies. You need to add backup servers, things like that, to be able to survive failures. But other than that, I think it's much better to start with the cloud. And even if you have a sustained traffic where you can think about, oh, maybe it's better to have our own data center, most of these guys these days provide some provision upfront models. So if you know that in the next 6 to 12 months, your traffic is going to be pretty much the same, you can buy upfront these boxes, and the cost will go drastically down. And it will be obviously a bit more expensive than running your own servers, but you save many things. And that's something you should consider. And the problem with the cloud is that many people end up wasting a lot of money, either because they don't know about these provision models, or sometimes they don't really like use the auto-scaling capabilities of this platform. So for instance, in Amazon, if you are expecting some traffic, let's say, on a Friday evening, you can have some auto-scaling groups inspecting your instances. And if your CPU goes higher than, let's say, 60%, you can automatically spin up new boxes. You pay a little bit more for that period of time, but you don't need to pay for all these servers during 6 months or 12 months. And many people don't do that. So if you're running in the cloud, please consider these options. And obviously, all this ends up affecting how the teams are composed these days. There was an excellent talk this morning about the DevOps philosophy by Jeremy. And I think he made some valid points here. Some people think that the DevOps movement is mostly about automating, using Ansible, Chef, Puppet, whatever tool you like. And there's a big amount of work involved with these technologies, and there's lots of automation. But I really think that it's more about being able to communicate. So for many years, developers have been separated from the ops team. And I think this is fundamentally wrong. I think I've been doing DevOps before it became trendy, because I've always been interested in ops problems. So I was that developer who went to the ops room and started bothering them, asking about questions, trying to configure servers better. And I think the industry needs to change, like Jeremy said, and like all this DevOps movement is saying, bringing again together developers and ops guys, sharing responsibility. And I wonder if, given some time, this dedicated ops role will maybe not disappear, but it will not be that needed. So maybe you can end up contracting in two or three companies. But having permanent dedicated ops teams, considering you can run in the cloud these days and considering all these tools, may become a little bit not that needed unless you are something very big. And obviously, you need very specialized people for helping you solving your problems. So another myth, in my opinion, is the full stack developer. They're very useful in startups because obviously you don't have the budget to hire 20 developers. So having people who are flexible in terms of like being comfortable to changing some backend code, but also some frontend code, spinning out some servers, it's great. But let's be realistic. Every single thing in our industry is becoming more and more specialized. So there's a point where it's pretty much impossible to be good at everything. However, at the same time, I think it's good to have transversal skills. And if you want to be successful in your career, there's no point in just staying in your silo coding PHP and, well, it works in my machine, end of work, I'm going for lunch, and it's your problem. I think it's good to be a little bit more flexible and have transversal skills. And another thing that happens, especially if you are starting building complex architectures, is this concept of having architect roles or platform teams. I've been in those positions sometimes in the past, but I'm not a big fan, because what ends up happening is that new silos emerge. So maybe this platform team is sitting in a different room from the rest of the developers, and you know they try to build a very fancy platform, fully tested, blah, blah, blah. But communication stops, and at some point, maybe the developers using that platform find it that it's not really useful. So I think even if it's OK to have architects and platform guys, they need to be building features from time to time and test their own platform, building actual things for the company. And one concept that is proven very valid in the past in some companies I've been is this wisdom committee kind of thing. So it was pretty much an informal meeting every week or every 2 weeks where representatives of every development team gathered together and tried to create some sort of like systems development common strategy. And this way, communication emerged, everybody starts trusting each other, and it's a good thing for the company, mostly. And ultimately, sometimes funding engineers join these teams because they are the guys who have been there forever. And it's usually OK, but sometimes you need to consider if having experienced people is better than just having funding engineers because they are the people who have been in the company the longer. So let's start with the big chunk of the talk, which is distributed systems, SOA, and all these hype words. So let's start with some definitions, thanks Wikipedia, because sometimes it's hard to define things. So a distributed system is a collection of independent computers that appear to its users as a single coherent system, blah, blah, blah. What is really important about distributed systems is that you can very easily achieve very nice things with them, like horizontal scalability, resilience, fault tolerance, and it's pretty much the way to go. Horizontal scalability is much better than vertical scalability, because there will be a point where there is no a bigger instance. So as soon as you have two instances doing the same thing in a distributed system, adding more instances is pretty much a matter of adding power. It has some costs, but it's pretty much straightforward once you have gone from one server to two servers. And ultimately, think about that. I mean, why distributed systems happen? Well, there are pretty much three reasons. The first one is because some things just don't fit in one box. So you may have a database storing hundreds of gigabytes. And at some point, MySQL, PostgreSQL, even with the bigger instances available, they just cannot cope with the load. So it's much better to split them into two or four servers in a cluster. Another situation where a distributed system is very useful is where you need to compute many things in parallel. So even the biggest instance with maybe 32 cores is not enough. And it's much better to have smaller instances where you can distribute the load. And a third scenario, which is possibly the trickiest one, is if you're running a global application and you have people using, let's say, your e-commerce website, some from Singapore, some from Russia, some from New Zealand, some from South Africa, some from Brazil, I mean, you need to choose between either having your infrastructure in one region and sacrifice latencies for most of them, or go through the hassles of replicating the data all over the place and be able to run your infrastructure in several regions. And this is, in my opinion, one of the trickiest scenarios. So there are important trade-offs of that in that situation, and you always need to be cautious about that before making decisions. And the thing is that the reality is that distributed systems are hard, no matter how they try to sell us these things. If you read the documentation for any database, it looks like, oh, this database scales automatically. You just add power and it works. It's never like that. Trust me, it's never like that. And you know, these days, when you are starting a new project, you think, OK, I'm going to use a different database for that project. But then you get all these options. And if you read the documentation for all of them, they all claim to be perfect in every scenario, from one server to millions of servers. And it's never like that. So all these technologies have their sweet spot. They have their perfect use cases. And they all of them have horror scaling stories and many scenarios where they just don't work properly. So if you are running a system which moves money, don't use Mongo Redis, use some transactional database. If you're running some time series data, don't use a graph database. Use some database that is suited for that purpose. But sometimes it's a bit tricky because all of them are trying to introduce features from the other. So these days, databases like Mongo have some sort of SQL language, but then databases like PostgreSQL have some NoSQL support. So it's good because having these new features in them allows you to stay with a limited set of technologies in your system, but it makes it even trickier to decide which one is the better to go. So be very careful before introducing a new database just because it's fancy. Don't believe what Hacker News says, because they never tell you all the process they've been through until they were successful running Cassandra, Elasticsearch, or all these fancy databases that are appearing and becoming more popular these days. And be very careful. So if you read about the documentations again, you'll see that most of them mention the CAP theorem. And the CAP theorem is pretty much explained with these three properties. You quite likely have read about them. And what the theorem says is that you can only guarantee two out of these three. And the first time you read these definitions, well, you can pretty much grasp them. But it took me a while to really understand what this meant. So I think a much better definition for the CAP theorem is that one. So during a network partition, a distributed system needs to choose between either consistency or availability. And if you think about that, think about a cluster of, let's say, six nodes, which may be a cluster of a single database. And the six nodes are connected to each other, and they are talking to each other. Everything gets propagated, master slave, or even master master. Everything looks fine. But whenever one or two nodes have a network problem talking to the others, well, you can choose between having a strong availability so that all the nodes can still respond, but you need to sacrifice the fact that this node that is disconnected is not getting the updates from the other ones. And this may be fine for some applications, and this may be a terrible decision for some others. So there's one trade-off here. The other option is to stay with strong consistency, but sacrifice availability. So that node that gets disconnected, if you need all the nodes to have the data really fresh, you just need to not tear them down, but don't make it listen to write requests, because it cannot simply propagate those requests to the other nodes. And there's no workaround for that. So I think this is a much better definition for the CAP theorem. And I think it's much more easy to see the problem that happens in a network partition. So if you're wondering where most databases fall, I mentioned that you can only get two out of three, but some systems behave between two of the three, depending on the mode they are. So this is the sweet spot that no database has achieved yet. But pretty much all of them try to minimize these scenarios. So if you think about if you want strong availability and strong consistency, pretty much you cannot have network partition. So either you have a single node, or if there is a problem in the network, your system will be totally down. And this is what happens with, for instance, some Percona clusters with MySQL master-master replication. So for some applications that cannot sacrifice not being able to replicate that data, in the event of a partition tolerant, all the system goes down. And this is, you know, the trade-off they've chosen for some MySQL clusters. Realistically, I think this is the area where most databases fall, and this is pretty much acceptable. Even if you have a MySQL master slave setup, even if the nodes are properly connected, there's always going to be a delay between what you read in the slave and what you have in the master. So pretty much eventual consistency It's been there for a while, and many people are happy about that. And there are databases who are more suitable for the big data hype, which are these ones here. And I think this is the way to go to scale to petabytes or whatever is the new word for millions of petabytes, which is exabytes, or I don't remember. And there are some technologies here that they sacrifice the availability. They stay with strong consistency and sacrifice availability. And this happens because in their setup, some of the nodes have special roles. In Cassandra, Record, DynamoDB, all the nodes have the same role, so they are all kind of masters. But here, in ZooKeeper, there's one master that elects things, and there are two others that are listening for that master to fail. And if that master fails, there is a moment where the system becomes unstable until it self-heals. So depending on the way they are trying to use the CAP theorem, some databases fall here, some databases fall here. And again, before introducing some database to the system, read through fully the documentation and try to understand what will happen whenever a network partition happens. Because we think that the network never fails, and it's pretty much stable, but you need to think that there are lots of cables through the ocean from Europe to America, or I don't know, to Australia, where they go through. But something as simple as a shark biting one of these cables can turn your system down for a while until it gets rerouted to some of the cables. So network partitions do happen. And there's nothing worse than not knowing what's going on with your database. You start looking at Hacker News, you start looking everywhere. Nobody's telling you the bad things about the databases, so be very careful and try to simulate network failures to see how your system will behave in these scenarios. So let's go to the SOA and microservices. It's all about small chunks of software that do one thing and do it right, and they are reusable, and there's a clear chain of calls. But if you have introduced services in your system, you may have ended up with something like this, which doesn't look particularly great. And that's very common. So you look back when SOA was envisioned some years ago, it was all about having self-contained units of functionality that can talk to each other via some contract that you share and some schema. So each service defines how you need to call it and what's the response going to look like. And the good thing is that you stop having a monolithic application, but you have small chunks of software that can evolve independently, be reused, or even be completely replaced by a new technology. So if you have a process in your application that is very slow with PHP and you are doing SOA, maybe you can take that PHP process out and introduce Go or Java, which is going to become much faster. And you are only touching a single bit of your application, not everything, which is pretty good. But then, obviously, it's not that easy. You need some orchestration on top of it. And if you think about SOA, I think SOA has failed many times. And there are many reasons why this happens. So I think the first thing we need to consider is that it's hard to explain the business value. So imagine you're a CEO, you have no idea of technology, your business is doing fine, it's generating millions, and there's a developer or the architect that comes to your room and says, hey, boss, I've got a great idea. We need to go to SOA. And the guy says, but what's the benefit of that? And so, we can reuse things and say, well, am I generating more value out of it? And you will say, no, it's actually going to cost you more because you need more servers. So it's very hard to sell. And we are terrible at doing these things. And even worse, if we manage to convince the boss, some companies treat SOA as a project that will start and will end after 3 or 6 months because, it's only about changing a monolithic architecture to services-oriented architecture. So pretty much a project, you can do a Gantt diagram, you can assign some resources to it, and some people think that after the project is done, everything will magically be better. And it's not like that. Moving to SOA has a strong impact in the organization. You need to define very well how the services are connected to each other, who is responsible for what, how whenever you add a new feature to the system that affects, let's say, 3 or 4 services, how is this going to work? Will 3 teams be synchronized to work at the same time in that feature? So it's not that simple. And most of the times, the problem is that we do SOA on the cheap, and possibly you know what I'm talking about. We don't dedicate enough resources. We are not strict enough. And we are terrible at explaining the business, the value of it. And possibly, there's also sometimes some teams that are not experienced enough to drive such a change. because new complexities are added with these different architectures, and it's not that easy. So the SOA concept has been bloated for a while, and these days everybody's talking about microservices. And if you read what a microservice is, it's pretty much most of the ideas of SOA. The main difference is that possibly SOA is about integrating different apps by a common message bus, and microservices is even more granular, so you divide a single app into even smaller chunks of code, but pretty much most of the concepts are the same. And if we decide to move to microservices, there are many things that we need to take into account, and I'll try to show you the problems that happen. So the first question would be, OK, you said microservices, so how micro should they be? And there's no answer for that. I mean, some people say that if it has more than 10 lines, it's not a microservice. I think it's a bit stupid. But if you think about maybe having some microservices, some microservice who is responsible for instance, resizing images, maybe it really has 3 lines of code. And it's absolutely fine to have this completely isolated. However, if you are thinking about the user service, how big does the user service need to be? Do we split the user service into the profile service and the geographic service for addresses and the payment storage service? And so where's the line between that? And it's complex. And some people are abusing from what I call nanoservices. And yes, a microservice is a small independent unit of code that does something, but that's a function. And a microservice shouldn't be a function. So if you are trying to split your application into microservices, don't go for nanoservices. Start dividing it by logic units of work. Don't do microservices, do services. And then you may discover some tricky points where it's worth having microservices. But think about this fact. If you have many services, like imagine that example that I described, the user service split into 4 microservices. A single profile update needs to touch 5 services. So how many intercall latencies, how much complexity is added just for the sake of being fancy? You're not adding any value, and you're adding lots of complexity, and lots of new errors will happen. So how do services talk to each other? Well, there's this concept of orchestration layer, which is the one that's responsible for interoperation. But that bit can become extremely complex. So if your business model is complex, you may have the wrong idea that moving to microservices will simplify it. But their complexity is not going to disappear. So you may be able to split some chunks of your application into microservices. But then the bit of complexity will not disappear. And some people end up moving their complexity to the orchestration layer. So you have ended having the same complexity just somewhere else in the orchestration layer, and you have added all the complexities of the intercall latency. So be very careful about that. And think about the orchestration layer, which is one of the most important bits for microservices. And this is not where many companies start. And I think that's the first bit to be considered when you are moving to microservices. Another concept that you may think why is needed is the concept of service discovery. So you may have some microservices running somewhere, and you may name them somehow. But how do you manage to find these boxes that are executing those microservices? So service discovery is all about having a directory of services, being able to register them, and then finding them. But this sounds pretty much like DNS. But the truth is that DNS was created, like many things in the web, about 20, 30 years ago, so it was a completely different world. If you have run your own DNS servers, you will know that it's hard to make them highly available. Obviously, these days, you have tools like Amazon 53, which makes life easier, but still, if you need to run your own infrastructure, it's tricky. DNS was also designed for standard ports, so you think about when you register an A record, you don't specify a port, you just specify an IP address. And these days, we may run services in any like random port, because this is how microservices start, especially if you're using Docker or things like that. It can become a mess, so there's no place for standard ports anymore. And another problem is that DNS was not optimized for real-time changes. In this microservices world, you may have a traffic spike, and then thanks to all these auto-scaling features I mentioned before with cloud providers or even in your own infrastructure, you may end up having not only 3 servers doing this microservice thing, but maybe 10. So you need these discovery tools need to be fast enough so that as soon as the service is ready to listen to requests, register those boxes and be able to use them. So DNS was meant to do that, but it's not enough. And I think there are tools like Consul these days, but it needs to mature a little bit more. And in the next couple of years, lots of technologies will appear, and this problem will be completely solved. But these days, it's still a bit tricky. Don't know how fans you are about unit testing. Hopefully, you are doing tests in your application. But in microservices, the problem is a bit different. So depending on how small they are, unit tests really doesn't add much value. Because what are you testing? You are mocking the HTTP interface, and you are mocking another microservice, and the amount of application logic that you are testing is very minimal. So most of the times, it's not only about unit testing your microservices, but testing the whole chain of calls. So you need to write integration tests, and most importantly, load tests. Because as I mentioned before, new complexities are added. They say that each microservice should have its own storage. So there are many things that can go wrong. So you need to test all these things and see how the system will behave once it's set into production. And it's tricky to test connectivity problems, database problems, things like that. And apart from that, if you are writing integration tests or end-to-end tests, you know that they are hard to maintain. Because every single time a functionality gets added, you need to review your whole testing strategy. So testing microservices as well becomes a bit tricky. So just bear in mind, I'm not trying to discourage you from using microservices. I think they are here to stay, like it or not. But be very cautious before starting them blindly. And start simple, bit by bit, and keep iterating, which is the way we should all work. So another question that you may ask, how services communicate to each other? Well, there are many ways of doing that. Possibly, the easiest one is using something we are familiar with, some JSON HTTP request. That's absolutely fine. Some people say HTTP is slow. Slow compared to what? I mean, it's pretty much, there are very effective parsers for HTTP. And it's something we are familiar with. And I think it's pretty much OK to use HTTP. It's not, so if your system is slow, it's not going to be slow because of the HTTP parsing. There will be many more problems in the chain of calls. However, there are some applications that listen to some binary protocols, like Protobuf, which was developed by Google, or Apache Thrift. It's absolutely fine to use them as well. I mean, they are sometimes a bit trickier, but they provide some good. So depending on what you are trying to achieve, they may be fine. And arguably, they are slightly faster than plain HTTP, so you may gain some seconds in there, or milliseconds, or even microseconds. And these 3 ways are basically for synchronous requests. However, most of the times, you communicate between services in an asynchronous way. And there are pretty much 2 different ways of doing that. So the first one, which is possibly the one you are more familiar with, is you introduce some sort of queue system where you publish messages, and there are workers on the other side trying to do some sort of like first in, first out model where your application produces things here and these workers can take these messages and do something else. You can really scale horizontally this very easily. And this is quite nice and it works pretty well. However, there is a maybe more interesting approach, which is instead of just having a queue, you have some sort of message bus where you keep messages that your application has generated for, let's say, maybe 1 day or a week. And you have all different async workers working each one at its pace. So there's not only one offline worker consuming that message, but eventually 10 of them for different things. So imagine you are publishing some sort of payment event here. And with this payment event, you may want to do many things. You may want to add some fraud detection. You may want to add some heuristics. You may want to have some machine learning trying to detect fraud behaviors. You may add some stats. So I think that approach is the way we should think about more than this queue that pretty much is one first in, first out. Obviously, some queue systems allow you to do some sort of fan out exchange or like publish to many channels, but the idea of that, I think it matches much better with the idea of the message bus than the queue system. So we've talked about that, but imagine you have successfully achieved to move to microservices. And you are building a booking ticket application. So a simple action, like booking a ticket, will involve something like that. So you may start calling the validation service, and the validation service asynchronously will publish something to the audit service. Then if the validation service is fine, there will be a synchronous call to the seating allocation service. And the seating allocation service, if you manage to allocate a seat, it will call the user service to get the details. And then it will call to the fraud system, which will call the payment service, which will call the analytics service. And we are having all this back and forth all the time. So it's not, there's nothing bad in doing that, but the complexity added is quite significant. So again, don't blindly go with microservices if you don't have the time to do that and the resources to, you know, maintain these systems. And what is worse is not only you have all these 9 or even more services. Each one of those can be a chain of a proxy, a load balancer, some servers doing the business logic, and each one of them can have a dedicated database. So for such a simple thing, like booking a ticket, where in plain good old PHP and MySQL, you would do a synchronous chain of calls, and it should work fine, you may have 50 to 60 HTTP requests here in the, out in the wild. And as you know, timeout can happen. And what happens when you get a timeout? If it's a GET request that doesn't alter the state, you can pretty much retry, and nothing will happen. But in the payment service, you cannot achieve idempotence. So what should we do? It's very hard to recover from failures. And remember that if we are here, having a problem here may happen after we have already allocated the seat. So you are lost. You have lost all the goods of assets, so all the goods of the transactions. And it's very tricky. And sometimes, depending on how you are monitoring your services or how you construct your error handling, it's hard to know what happened. So it can be that a server was down, but maybe there was a problem in the network. Or maybe the database was down. Or maybe the database just had some lock. Or there was a network issue. And also, there are always 2 timeouts. And we are not very familiar with that. So most of the time, we only think about the timeout calling to an external service. But in this microservices architecture, you have a second timeout, which is the time you are waiting for a response. And we have a chain of those. So, you know, things become very tricky. And again, I'm not discouraging you from trying these approaches. I'm just saying that it's not as fancy and as easy as some companies seem to say that it is. And some other problems that you can very easily see is that one microservice can take everything down, especially if it's one of the ones at the bottom. You need to add health checks, constant monitoring, and instrumentation. So there's a lot of DevOps work involved and a lot of ops work in terms of providing dashboards to be able to react. And one of the worst things is that availability goes down. So if we have just a chain of 3 services, and each one of them has 2 nines, combining the 3 of them, you get 3% of errors already. So, you know, there are some things that happen. And you may be absolutely fine having this error rate slightly lower. But things like banks, like, you know, if you are doing a software for some sort of stock, warehouse or something like that, they cannot tolerate these things. So pretty much the old model can still be valuable in many scenarios. So it's pretty much up to the team to decide if all this hassle is worth it. And technically speaking, it's really worth it because you face lots of challenges and it's lots of fun. However, you also need to think about how much value you are delivering to your company and think if all these approaches can ultimately even harm the company. So let's talk a little bit about data analysis, because all businesses need it. We talked about having NoSQL databases. And if you think about it, once you introduce a NoSQL database, you introduce complexities in when you try to exploit your data. SQL is great, because even if you don't have an index for a field, you can always query by that field. It may take an hour, but it will produce a result. However, in NoSQL, there's not only no standard, but most of the times, you cannot query by any arbitrary field. So they are more limited. Most of the times, you only get some hash key and range key query. But it's quite limited. Or if you are using something like Neo4j, you have some complex graph syntax. But again, there's no standard. And this is why the MapReduce idea was invented. It was because you need processing to be able to compute results in the same way you did with SQL. So MapReduce is not a database. I always say that. Some people think MapReduce is a database. It's just an idea or a framework. And what you do is, instead of computing something with this chunk of data, what you do is You take little chunks, you produce intermediate results, you do some aggregation, and you do some final results. The good of this approach is that you can distribute the load, and again, you can pretty much scale horizontally. So even if you are analyzing petabytes with something like this system, given the power and given the resources and given the boxes, you can pretty much compute results in a similar way to what you would do with a select count or a select average with an SQL database. So Hadoop is the most prominent framework, the most known these days. Apache Spark has come. It's much faster. It's easier to code. The thing is that you may need some other languages. They are pretty much done in Java. There are some Python adapters. And as far as I know, there are some guys working in a PHP connector for Apache Spark, but it's pretty much experimental. So I mean, pretty much, if you are going to go that way, you may need to stop looking just at PHP and look at the other options in the market. And well, some people are obsessed about having real-time dashboards. What is real time? I mean, maybe 60 seconds of delay is just fine. However, if you are building a video game like I'm doing now, sometimes it's not acceptable because, you know, if you have a turn-based combat mechanic, you cannot have the other guy waiting for 60 seconds. So, however, most of the times, up to 60 seconds with something like what Ben demonstrated before, which is the Logstash Kibana aggregator, it takes some seconds to be there, but it's pretty much real time. The problem is, as I said before, what happens when you have clients all over the world? Either you sacrifice latency or you introduce the replication problem. And it's up to you to decide. So not strictly related to that, but taking, again, the idea of the aggregated stream, there's the concept of the firehose. And I think this is a much better way of logging events. And you will see this approach being taken by many companies in the next couple of months or years. So this concept was pretty much invented by Twitter. They call the firehose the real-time stream of tweets. And it's pretty much about having somewhere where you publish anything that happens in your application, and you have plenty of subscribers to that, and it's up to those subscribers to filter them and do actions related to those events. So technologies like Apache Kafka, if you're running in AWS, there's Kinesis, or pretty much with technologies like RabbitMQ or NSQ, allow you to do so. And the only problem is that you need to be very careful between the trade-offs between these different technologies. But pretty much these days, I think that instead of having these messy architectures with some Hadoop in here, some Redis queue in there to provide low latency, and many other technologies to provide some sites to the data, I think that that's a much better approach. So what you would have here is that all your services are publishing to an event stream, which is some sort of unified log. And then you can have different subscribers to that. So you can even have third parties subscribe to them. So maybe you are using a third-party email marketing tool, you are using some CRM system, or some analytics. Most of them provide you ways to giving access them to your event stream, or they expose an HTTP API, so you can pretty much have some connectivity from your service to them. And inside your own servers, you may have some high latency processes for big data analysis or machine learning analysis. And you can also have some workers trying to produce real-time dashboards. So I think this idea of the unified log for modern stream processing is something that it's happening more and more. And when I was preparing this talk, I wanted to, put this idea in a graph, but I was lucky enough to attend an AWS meetup from this guy, Alexander Dean, who precisely explained that. And I think it summarizes pretty much what I wanted to say. So I pretty much stole the idea from his slide, but I'm crediting him, so I hope he doesn't get pissed off if he ever sees that. So yeah, what about us? I mean, if you think about microservices, PHP was never meant to do that. And you don't have threading, you don't have multi-core processing, is there any hope? Or should we retire? Or maybe just admit that we need to stop doing PHP? Well, PHP has some good things, but also some bad things. So the good things are very clear. So they have been discussed many times. So there's libraries for everything. There's lots of community. A proof is like 700 people are gathering together here today. There's lots of documentation. So this is I'm doing Java. And guys, the Java documentation is so terrible. I mean, if you compare that to PHP.NET, there's such a big difference. And PHP was created for the web, for the HTTP framework. So I think there's still room for PHP. And there are still many companies running it. So I don't know if you ever heard of a company called YouPorn, but Etsy, Yahoo, and many, many e-commerces are still using PHP. And there's nothing wrong with that. Yeah, you all know about YouPorn. Yeah. Imagine that. The problem with PHP is that it's pretty slow. I mean, these days, if you follow the internals, you need some alcohol before reading some of the blog posts, but it's quite OK. Even with PHP 7, that it's promised that it's maybe twice faster or something like that, it will still be slow. I mean, some Hello World in Java, it's 30 to 40 times faster than the fastest Hello World you can achieve in PHP. And it will always be like that, because it's a compile language. And also, you know, if you have been working with PHP, yeah, sometimes weird things happen. And for me, the biggest problem with PHP is that the lack of thread. Yeah, there's this PNCTL extension that allows you to do some forking, but it's a bit wonky, and it doesn't work really well. And another reality is that we don't have a great reputation in other communities. Most people think that the average PHP developer is still this guy that is running a WordPress instance and hacking a little bit, you know, with the CSS. But it's not true. I mean, there are lots of big projects written in PHP, so it's up to us to prove them wrong. And we are catching up, a bit slowly, but we are catching up. So scenarios where you shouldn't use PHP, and we do, at least I have done it wrongly many times. So if you're doing heavy math calculations, massive data processing, if you're running CLI processes, well, PHP has become better at that. But if you are using something like Python or Go, they are millions of times ahead of PHP. Obviously, if you want to do threading or forking or message passing, PHP is not just not for that. You can build things, but it's, again, not ideal. So ultimately, you have high concurrency scenarios, like a video game, where you cannot catch requests, where pretty much every request is some progression of the player. You need to consider alternatives to PHP. And arguably, if you are trying to create some DSLs, well, if Constantine, the creator of Behat, was here, would say that it was not that bad. But writing DSLs for something like parsing Gherkin, it's a bit tricky with PHP. And languages like Ruby are much better for that. So which languages should we use? Well, there are many. But in my opinion, one of them is Erlang. Good things about Erlang is that it's extreme light. It's very easy to fork processes, and they will stay very, very light. There's the OTP framework. It's very mature. It was created in the 80s, and it's been running since that without many changes. Obviously, they published new releases, but the concepts were there 30 years ago already. And there are many projects which are very successful written in Erlang. So pretty much, RabbitMQ is written in Erlang. React, which is a massive big data database, written again in Erlang. WhatsApp, small application that you may know as well, was pretty much written in Erlang. And only 50 engineers, or something like that, have built the whole WhatsApp, which is pretty significant. And it tells a lot about this language. However, not everything is as fancy. So the first time you look at some Erlang code, it's so alien that you can pretty much not understand anything. It has concepts like pattern matching in functions, immutability inside functions. So they are not very weird. But if you are used to the usual PHP flow, you need to completely switch your mind. There's a steep learning curve. It's hard to find people who have experience in Erlang. And in PHP, we have lots of string functions, which are very handy. In Erlang, it's a bit tricky to do that. So, well, depending on what you do, if you are building a chat server, don't do it with PHP. Possibly Erlang is a much better choice. But if you are running, you know, writing business code, maybe Erlang is not the best language for that. So you may have heard about Go. Very trendy these days. Lots of companies using it, at least here in London. I had the opportunity to have some Go exposure when I was working at Halo. Easy to deploy, fast compile, lots of hype. Pretty much easier to learn how to do things with Go. And still pretty light. Not as light as Erlang, but pretty much the same. However, once you start writing code in Go, even though the standard library is extremely well documented, extremely stable, when you start using libraries to connect to databases, you will discover that many of them are still really mature. So it looks like going back to PHP 4 with the extensions back in the day. I mean, you have nasty bugs in the simplest things like connecting to Memcache or Redis, where, you know, if you keep the process running for a while, you will see memory leaks everywhere. And this is just because they have not been battle tested yet. It's just a matter of time. So if we were talking about Golang in 2 years from now, I would possibly erase that line. But if you are trying to use Go at this moment, you will face those issues. Another problem, which I really hate, is that they don't have exceptions. So it's pretty much like in the 70s with COBOL or these languages where you had an error and you had to bubble the error up. So most of the times the Go code is if error or is different to nil, do that. If error is different to nil, do that. And I mean, we have tried catch for 20 years. I mean, let's not go back in time. So I hope one day they will reconsider that. It's quite unlikely to happen, but I really hope someone in the Go community starts thinking about that. Again, a difference with Erlang is that if you spam Go routines, it's hard to recover from panics. And it's not great for business logic either. So it may be OK for small microservices, as I was describing. But if you're building an e-commerce where lots of complex business logic happens, maybe Go is not the best tool for that. And there is something in the JVM that you have loved about that when I said I said that I was doing Java these days. But you cannot deny that the JVM is super stable. It's been there for almost 15 to 20 years now. There are libraries for everything. And since Scala is running in the JVM, all the Java libraries who are pretty much battle-tested are accessible from Scala. And this is why it's getting lots of momentum. So many people who have been working with the JVM are doing Scala these days, because it's slightly faster to code. You don't have all this abstract factory pattern, well, whatever Java has, as you may know if you are, have ever used Spring or some framework like this. And there are starting to appear tools like Akka, which provides an actor model similar to the Erlang model. SVT is their composer, in to be quotes. And I'm using Play Framework, which is not really like Symfony, but it's pretty much an HTTP framework. And if you come from these languages from the web, you may find it very easy to get started with. The problem with Scala is, you know, it's still slow to compile. There are incompatibilities, for instance, between Scala 2.10 and 2.11. So it's still not immature, but still a bit complicated to work with it. So again, I still think that PHP has a lot of things to do in the new world. However, look beyond PHP. I didn't mention anything about Node.js or C++ or Clojure. But if you like them, give them a try. They may solve some of your problems in a much easier way than what you would do with PHP. So we're pretty much running out of time. And I think I calculated more or less a bit wrongly, but still have a couple of minutes. So the future, I think it will be fascinating. I mean, even if we have done lots of things in the internet, we are still starting. And there's one thing coming, and someday it will be easy to define, which is the Internet of Things. And I think the Internet of Things will generate big data, and new problems will happen, and we will have lots of work and exciting engineering work in the next couple of years. So it's all about trade-offs, and PHP is not enough for many of these needs. But I honestly think that PHP is not going anywhere, so don't worry. You're pretty much safe. It's good to learn Erlang, Go, Java, whatever. But PHP is not going anywhere, and especially now that Gen has finally started to care about performance, I think there's a bright future for us as well in the next couple of years. So don't blindly follow the trends. Always read the docs, choose the right tool, and just a last phrase that I will let you some seconds to read. It's all about don't complicate things upfront. Start simple, and when you really need fancier things, introduce them. But don't start doing complicated things, because it's quite likely that it's going to fail. So thank you. And now I don't know if we have a couple of minutes to take some questions. And please rate this talk, or thank you.
Hi there. Amazing talk. So I work for a company called Pusher, and we're a hosted service, basically a WebSocket hosted service. So what you didn't mention there, you mentioned infrastructure in terms of, say, Amazon, basically hosting, but you didn't kind of say where hosted services such as Pusher or INMQ or, oh, sorry, iron.io fit into your idea of this sort of thing. So that's like offloading the message queue functionality.
Ah, okay, okay.
So yeah. Where do hosted services fit into, if people want to just do PHP, for instance?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So that's a very interesting question, and we could discuss about that for over a beer or something. I guess it depends on how much of your infrastructure you are able to run, or you are willing to run, and how much budget you have to outsource. So there's always a bit of a trade-off in there. It's hard to say. I mean, as I described in the big picture of the modern stream processing, I think using third parties for CRM or something like you were describing, it's absolutely fine. You need to consider that sometimes these hosted services, you never control what's going on, so maybe they have some issues that will affect your system, and there's nothing you can do apart from phoning them and trying to rant at them or shout at them. But so it's again a bit of again a trade-off between how much of your infrastructure you are willing to run or you are accepting to run versus how much you are accepting that it's not in your hands, but you save all the hassle of setting that up and maintaining that. So I don't have a real answer for that, but I think it absolutely fits, and it's up to you again to decide, considering the trade-offs, obviously, like anything. No more questions? Sorry about the time, but we had some problems, so bear with me a little bit. I hope you still get some coffee and cake, so it's not going to be too much. Thank you, guys.